Morning. This is Dr. Adel Bondok, professor of anatomy and neuroscience, Mansoura University, Egypt. I am going to talk about the femur. I will talk about the gross features and the special features. Start by the gross features. The femur is a long bone. It is the bone. It is the skeleton of the thigh. It is the longest bone. It is about 45 centimeters long. Being a long bone, it is formed of two ends and shaft. The two ends, upper end and the lower end. The upper end is formed of head, neck, greater trochanter, and lesser trochanter. The two trochanters are connected anteriorly by the intertrochanteric line and connected posteriorly by the intertrochanteric crest. So the upper end, head, neck, greater trochanter, lesser trochanter, intertrochanteric line, intertrochanteric crest, which carries quadrate tubercle, this one. The lower end, two condyles, medial condyle and lateral condyle. And each condyle has epicondyle. And the medial condyle has also adductor, the lower end has adductor tubercle, this one. The shaft, in the middle third of the shaft, it is triangular in cross section. Therefore, it has three borders and three surfaces. The three borders, medial border, lateral border, and the posterior border. This posterior border is called the linea aspera. The three surfaces, anterior surface, posteromedial surface, and posterolateral surface. Let us talk about each part. This is the upper end of the femur. This is the front, this is the back. So the first part of the upper end is the head. The head is directed upward and medially. It articulates with the acetabulum to form the hip joint. It has a depression here. It's called the fovea. The neck. It is about 5 centimeters long. It forms an angle with the shaft of the femur about 125 degrees. Greater trochanter, which is lateral in position, it has trochanteric fossa medially. Then lesser trochanter, the two trochanters are connected anteriorly by the intertrochanteric line and connected posteriorly by the intertrochanteric crest, which has quadrate tubercle. This is the lower end. The lower end is formed of medial condyle and the lateral condyle. Okay, so medial condyle and the lateral condyle. The medial condyle projects downward more than the lateral condyle. Okay, so it projects downward more than the lateral. And the medial condyle has medial epicondyle and adductor tubercle. The lateral condyle, this is the lateral condyle. Okay. This is the lateral condyle. The lateral condyle is in line with the shaft of the femur. Okay, lateral condyle is in line with the shaft of the femur. That's why the lateral condyle transmits the weight of the body to the tibia, not the medial condyle. Okay? And the lateral condyle has lateral epicondyle and the groove below the lateral epicondyle for the popliteus muscle. The two condyles are separated posteriorly by this fossa, intercondylar fossa. And the two condyles are fused anteriorly and the carries patellar surface for the articulation with the patella. So the lower end is formed of two condyles, medial condyle and the lateral condyle. The medial condyle projects downward more than the lateral. The lateral condyle is in line with the shaft of the femur. That's why it transmits the weight of the body to the tibia. Each condyle has epicondyle. The medial condyle has adductor tubercle. The lateral condyle has groove for popliteus. The two condyles are separated posteriorly by the intercondylar fossa. The two condyles are continuous anteriorly and carries patellar surface for the articulation with the patella. Then the shaft. The shaft is divided into three parts, three thirds. Upper third, middle third, lower third. I will start by the middle third. The middle third is triangular in cross section. Therefore, it has three borders and three surfaces. The posterior border is called the linea aspera, and the linea aspera has two lips, and the two lips separate superiorly and separate inferiorly. The medial lip is continuous superiorly with the spiral line and the continuous inferiorly with the medial supracondylar ridge. The lateral lip is continuous superiorly with the gluteal tuberosity and the continuous inferiorly with the lateral supracondylar ridge. So this is the middle third, three borders and three surfaces. Upper third. Upper third has a spiral line and the gluteal tuberosity. The spiral line is continuous with the medial lip of the linea aspera. The gluteal tuberosity is continuous with the lateral lip of the linea aspera. The lower third. Medial supracondylar ridge and the lateral supracondylar ridge. Medial supracondylar ridge is continuous with the medial lip of the linea aspera. Lateral supracondylar ridge is continuous with the lateral lip. The surface between the two ridges is called the popliteal surface of the femur. So the popliteal surface is the area between the medial and the lateral supracondylar ridges. This popliteal surface is related to the popliteal artery. Therefore, supracondylar fracture of the lower end of the femur may compress the popliteal artery. Articulations of the femur. Upper end. The upper end articulates with the hip bone. The head of the femur articulates with the acetabulum of the hip bone to form the hip joint. And the hip joint is ball and the socket synovial joint. The lower end. This is the lower end of the femur, the femoral condyles. These are the tibial condyles, and this is the patella. The lower end of the femur articulates with the upper end of the tibia. The condyles of the femur articulate with the condyles of the tibia and with the patella to form the knee joint. And the knee joint is condylar or modified hinge synovial joint. Regarding the special features, start by the head. The head has depression called the fovea. The fovea gives the attachment to the ligamentum teres of head of femur, or round the ligament of head of femur. What is the importance of this ligament? This ligament, it connects the fovea, okay, to the acetabular notch. It carries the acetabular artery from the obturator artery to supply the femur head in children. It is very important in children, but it lost this function in the adult. What is the arterial supply of the head of the femur? This is the head of the femur. What is the arterial supply of the head of the femur? It has double blood supply. The main arterial supply is from the retinacular arteries. These are the retinacular arteries which run along the neck of the femur. Retinacular arteries mainly from the medial circumflex femoral artery, from the profunda femoris artery. The retinacular arteries run along the surface of the neck to reach the head. The second source is the acetabular artery from the obturator artery. It reaches the head through the ligamentum teres of the head of the femur. It is important in newborn and in children, but it lost this function in the adult. So what is avascular necrosis of the head of the femur? Avascular necrosis of the head of the femur is due to loss of the arterial supply to the head. It occurs in fracture neck of femur due to cut of the retinacular arteries. regarding the muscle attachment. Start by the greater trochanter. The greater trochanter gives the attachment to seven muscles. The seven muscles are gluteus minimus, attached to the anterior surface. Gluteus medius to the lateral surface. Obturator internus to the medial surface. Obturator externus trochanteric fossa. Piriformis to the top of the greater trochanter, upper border. Quadratus femoris to the quadrate tubercle. Vastus lateralis to the root of the greater trochanter. So what are the seven muscles attached to the greater trochanter? Gluteus minimus, anterior surface. Gluteus medius, lateral surface. Obturator internus, medial surface. Obturator externus, trochanteric fossa. Piriformis to the top. Quadratus femoris, quadrate tubercle. Vastus lateralis to the root of the greater trochanter. And this is the only origin. The other muscles are insertion. Lesser trochanter gives the attachment to only one muscle or one tendon, combined tendon, iliopsoas muscle. So the iliopsoas muscle is inserted into the lesser trochanter. Now the intertrochanteric line. This is the intertrochanteric line. Intertrochanteric line gives the attachment to four structures. The four structures, two muscles and two ligaments. The two muscles are 1, 2. Vastus lateralis is attached to the upper part. Vastus medialis attached to the lower part. And then capsule iliofemoral ligament and the capsule of the hip joint. So the four structures attached to the intertrochanteric line, two muscles and two ligaments. Two muscles, vastus lateralis upper part, vastus medialis lower part, the two ligaments, iliofemoral ligament and the capsule of the hip joint. Now the lower end of the femur, muscles attached to the lower end. Muscles attached to the lower end are five muscles. Okay, start by this one, the popliteal surface above the medial condyle. So this is the medial head of the gastrocnemius. Medial head of the gastrocnemius, popliteal surface above the medial condyle. Lateral head of the gastrocnemius above the lateral epicondyle. Then plantaris, popliteal surface above the lateral condyle. So the popliteal surface gives the attachment to two muscles, medial head of gastrocnemius and the plantaris. Then we have two muscles here. This one, origin of popliteus muscle below the lateral epicondyle and insertion of adductor magnus, ischial part of adductor magnus, adductor tubercle. So the muscles attached to the lower end of the femur, medial head of gastrocnemius, lateral head of gastrocnemius, plantaris, popliteus and adductor longus, adductor magnus, ischial part. Ligaments attached to the lower end, four ligaments, two collateral ligaments and two cruciate ligaments. Okay. This is the medial collateral ligament, is attached to the medial epicondyle. The medial collateral ligament is called the tibial collateral ligament. Lateral collateral ligament, or lateral or fibular collateral ligament, attached to the lateral epicondyle. Then two cruciate ligaments, anterior cruciate ligament attached to the medial surface of the lateral condyle, and the posterior cruciate ligament attached to the lateral surface of the medial condyle. Then regarding the muscles attached to the shaft, start by the linea aspera. Linea aspera gives the attachment to six muscles, three origin and three insertion. From medial to lateral, this is the first one, vastus medialis, medial lip, adductor longus, adductor brevis, adductor magnus, the pubic part, and then short head of the biceps, and the vastus lateralis, lateral lip. Gluteal tuberosity gives attachment to three muscles. This is the gluteal tuberosity. Of course, gluteus maximus, okay, and adductor magnus along the medial border, and the vastus lateralis along the lateral border. Origin of the three vastae and the articularis geno. This is vastus intermedius, this is vastus medialis, this is vastus lateralis. Start by vastus medialis. Enter trochanteric line, a spiral line. Medial lip of the linea aspera and the medial supracondylar ridge. Then vastus lateralis, root of the greater trochanter, enter trochanteric line, root of greater trochanter, lateral margin of the gluteal tuberosity and the lateral lip of the linea aspera. Then vastus intermedius, anterior and the lateral surface of the shaft, articulated genu, okay, lower part of the anterior surface of the shaft. And thank you very much, best wishes and good luck.